Welcome to Ask the Experts. I'm Jill Schlesinger, editor-at-large of CBSMoneyWatch.com, and I'm joined by...
Jack Otter, executive editor.
And...
And Ray Martin, special contributor.
You are special. You know,
thank you.
I've said that for... He's so,
so sweet.
Special. What a great day for you
special.
To be here with us, Ray, because the stock market's plunging.
Yep.
Now, is it a plunge? What do you think the right word is? I mean, you know, old school people like you and me who think, remember when 100 points in the Dow was a big deal? It's not a big deal anymore. Even 200 points is not a big deal. At what point do you say, uh-oh, this is scary? What's the actual percentage, or how do you feel about that?
Well, we've had about a 5 or 6% drop in the Dow right now, and you know, I think anytime you get into territory where you're seeing 5% or more of a drop in a couple of weeks, then people start getting concerned. At first, it starts out, you know, with a little bit. Oh, well, we'll see. It'll come back, but somewhere in that range.
And don't forget, Jack. Last year, from late April right through the summer, we were down. The Dow was down. I looked it up. 14%.
Was it down that far?
Isn't that amazing? So now I'm sort of like, this has been a little bit torturous because it's been going on. This is the seventh week it's been going on, the selling.
Until the last few days, really slow.
Right. And so the question is there something for investors to take away from this move? Is there something fundamentally that has changed? What should people be thinking about right now?
Well, in terms of the atmosphere, you know, back in, when did tails really started wagging? I think around January. In December, everyone was all glum and they seemed to be overdoing it on the downside. And then everybody got really happy about not that much. So I think the sentiment always exaggerates whatever's happening.
Right.
So sure, real estate's in trouble. Is that a headline? You know, it was a news flash. Greece, that could be a kind of a contagion if, depending on what happens, if the euro gets hit, what would happen? The dollar would go up. That would be tough for U.S. manufacturers. I mean, I'm trying to think in terms of actual real results and not just people worrying. But, you know, investors just can't keep themselves up at night worrying about this. You know, you always say it, set your allocation and then go away.
All right, something's buzzing, and we're just going to have a little moment here. We're not sure what it is.
Oh,
it could
be.
Oh, Ray is buzzing.
It could
Ooh,
be me. It
baby,
could be me.
Buzzing Ray. Oh my God, Victoria's going to hit you. She's going to hit you. All right, Ray turned it off. Okay, so Ray, you and I both were in the client business for many years. You still have clients, right?
Sure do. Yep.
So tell me about how. Like, give me the best and the worst of being in the client business. So, I mean, there are times where I'm sure you beg people and they say, no, I can't take it anymore. And they blow out at a bad time. So talk about that a little bit and how that's so hard to get someone back in.
Yeah, you know, the most poignant example you can think of is obviously the financial crisis we've just been through. The decline in 2008 and 2009 were precipitous. And if you had an asset allocation that you were overextended in stocks, and it wasn't suitable for you, then you really felt the pain of that.
Right.
The problem was that most people didn't really say, okay, now I want to sell, until the majority of that decline, that 30, 40 some odd percent decline, had materialized in their portfolio. And if you sold then and then didn't decide to get back in, you missed a massive rally back up when you saw underselling. You know, typically when you have a major market correction, I'm not saying that we're in one of those now. I think this situation that we're in now is different than the one a year and a half ago. But when you're in that situation, typically corrections overcorrect to the downside, and you have to realize when that is.
Right.
But on the same token, you have to have the right asset allocation for yourself to say, look, what's in stocks, I'm not touching for 4 or 5 years anyway, or longer.
And I'm sure you know, like, you have that battle with people, because when the market's really strong, Jack, what do people want to do? They're like, woohoo, I'm in it. I'm the stock investor. I'm great.
Well, and what people say is, you know what? I'll get back in when things settle down.
Just send me a memo about that.
Define settle down as going up for a long period. In other words, getting more expensive.
Right. And Ray, so what you bring up is that basically, if you're going to be market timing, you don't have to just make one really good decision. You got to make two. Well, you got
to
get out.
When to sell and when to get back in. And you got to make those two pretty much perfectly. And the odds of doing that are really difficult to do. But people who kept their money in stocks and maybe rotated, changed the allocation into some of the things that grew a lot in small cap, mid cap, foreign, emerging markets, have seen now today the stock portion of their portfolio is higher or at the same levels of October 07 or higher. So they've actually made some positive returns here, or significant returns in that respect. And those who are the right allocation in bonds actually preserved a lot of wealth and value too.
And so when
it works.
So if you're someone is listening to us right now, and and by the way, go to moneywatch.com and you can go into the chat room and send us questions, and you can always send us a question at asktheexperts@moneywatch.com. We'll get your questions. What do you say to somebody who's freaking out right now? Like, oh my God, I can't go through this again. I did the financial crisis. I hung in there, Ray. You told me to hang in there. I went through last spring, Jack. You told me not to panic. I stayed there. I'm just tired. I don't think I can do it anymore. What do we tell them?
Yeah. First, you know, good reason to be tired. I think we're all kind of tired. we're hoping we're not seeing another one. I think now you've got to look at the situation today and say, what are the fundamentals? First of all, okay, fundamentally, the economic news is not good, and it looks like it's slowing down, but slowing down, not imploding. Okay, there's a lot of backstops, a lot of things have been done to the economy, and a lot of the problems we know what they're on the table. But corporate profits are still there. You know, there's a reason why corporate profits are strong. It's because we have 9% unemployment. They're not hiring. You know, you don't have the expenses. So you make money at the top line, it goes right down to the bottom line. It's called positive operating leverage for companies. So corporate cash positions and profits are in great shape.
First of all, he just said positive operating leverage.
POL.
Paul. I'm your Paul, which is very impressive.
That's when, as you know, when your profits, or your revenues, your top line is growing faster than your expense line. So it expands your profit, positive operating leverage.
I like that.
Yeah. And, you know, I think there are a couple of tricks people can do to calm themselves down. Mm-hmm. I actually did this to myself. I remember the day in October 2008, the market lost 700 points.
Okay, I remember that because it was the Jewish high holidays. I swear to God, I totally remember this. I became
home. Is there a connection there?
I don't know. It could be.
Is there a correlation?
Jews had left, they got to temple, they were praying for the markets. No, seriously, I totally remember that day because I remember we left for temple in the morning and we came back and we were in my sister's kitchen and my brother-in-law and I, since my brother-in-law is a hedge fund guy and I'm managing money, and we both turn our Blackberries on and we're shellacked. We turn the TV on and it was down 700 points, and my brother-in-law said to me, oh my bleep in God, and we literally sat there and we talked each other out of doing anything. We said, we're not doing anything. There's no trade to be made. You're down 700. Like, don't do anything. And that was the first thing that I remember was there's like a great moment of clarity when you realize you're not going to make a great decision in the middle of a day like that, right?
Well, so what I did was I did something to make myself feel better, which didn't really risk my retirement. I was watching, you know, my retirement savings plummet. I knew intellectually, okay, the smart thing to do is to be a buyer, not a seller when everyone else is selling, but it's hard to do. So I put a tiny amount of money in an MLP. They really got killed. These are master limited partnerships that invest in oil pipelines. Just so I could do that. And okay, I felt now I've taken action. The next day, the market was up 600 or something.
Yeah, right. It was crazy.
So I would have been fine going into an index fund, but that thing is actually up more than 200% now.
Mm-hmm. Come on.
Off. Yeah, score.
Well, but I have enough to buy, you know,
Jack put
three sandwiches.
$500.
But he didn't do enough because he's still here.
Jack isn't.
But the positive effect was
some...
I fooled myself into thinking, okay, I've taken action and I felt better just because I did something. And that's what I think ever kills everyone is like, what can I do?
And you could do, you know.
Apple at 90?
Yeah, exactly.
Remember?
Well, I do remember making a trade of Citigroup under one. I remember, I'm like,
my wife
okay,
told me to do that, and I just didn't get on my
button
to do it.
I didn't do it for my clients, by the way, because I just said, you know what? Like, that's crazy. But I did put a little bit. I'm like, you know what? What the heck? Why is it really? If it goes broke, I risk a dollar. It's not the worst thing. But here's the thing that's interesting. If you're going to do something like that, that's your fun money account, right?
Exactly,
your gambling
that's right.
account. That's what you say. You know what? You want to have some fun, and you want to take a flyer on something, but you don't do that fundamentally. I always think the most important thing as in the middle of a day like today is try not to make a trade at all. Because there's probably, unless you were planning on it, because I'm sure that there are people who are sitting around and have some cash and said, you know what, I have to force myself to get in. Here's a place to start to get in. And you say, okay, I'm going to do 5% a month for the next 12 months, and I'm going to be back in the market in a way I want to be.
Right.
If you fundamentally had that game plan before, then today's not a bad day to start executing, right?
Right. Well, but also, if this is a good time to look at when the market goes down 5% or so, I look at it as a stress test. I look at your portfolio just got on the treadmill, it's breathing through the oxygen tube, and you're testing the heart rate. And if your portfolio is going down more than the market, look at your holdings and why. Yeah. Because times of volatility are a great time to check in and say, what is it I own that could be a disaster here? You know, if you own GE and Caterpillar and you look at the price earnings ratios of those in the 13s, 14s range or so, you know, you're going to say, look, that's fundamentally around where the market is valued. That's okay. If you own a lot of Green Mountain coffee roasters at a PE of 78 or 90, great product, great business model, but wow,
love
pay
my
that
coffee.
For a dollar of earnings.
Right.
You might want to say maybe it's time to take a little off the table here on some of those holdings. So use this as a time to consolidate, gather up, and look for good fundamental value in your investments.
And at the risk of market timing, I think we should point out that the companies that have done really well over the past 2 years have been those small cap, those riskier companies.
That's right. That's a good point.
Chris Davis said this on CNBC, so I guess I can say it on MoneyWatch. He called
Why do you have to mention that other place?
He called it a flight to crap. This was actually back in the previous, when the previous bubble was bouncing back. And this is a pattern that
it's
is
not a four-letter word for that, but yeah.
Fairly reliable is that in the early stages of a bull market, the small cap stocks surge, and then eventually the business cycle comes around and the bigger, safer companies sort of take hold. That seems to be what's going on right now, and it speaks to your stress test. If your portfolio's down 3% at the end of the day and the market's down 2%.
You got to figure out
why. Maybe you got too many small caps.
Right.
Right.
Use periods of time like this to check it out.
I love that. Stress test your own portfolio.
There you go.
I love that.
You got positive operating leverage out of me. You got stress test your portfolio.
My God,
how
you're a
that?
Font of information today, my man. All right, let's get to some questions. You know, guys, today we got another IPO in that tech space, Pandora, the streaming music site. And, you know, we've written extensively on MoneyWatch.com about LinkedIn. Here's a question from Brian who wants to know, would you recommend a buy on the pending Groupon IPO? Jack?
I think there's really a lot of froth in this internet 2.0, whatever you want to call it. People are so excited about these offerings, and it's just not logical. Now, even if you forget the whole internet thing, we know that generally IPOs go down in the first six, 8 months after the offering. They're doing a lot faster in these things. You know, the LinkedIn IPO is seen as a success. It's not a success. It hit the tape at $83 for real people. That's when you could buy that $45 stock.
Right.
It's selling at 70-something today.
Right.
So that's lost money for the regular Joe who waited to get in. And it's, you know, Pandora.
Pandora came out this morning and was up about 40%, up at 20, in the low 20s, right? And right now trading 18 change right now. So basically you could have lost money just in the first day of trading. How nice for you. So what's your advice to people who really, they are very tantalized by the IPO market, Ray? How do we settle them down? Maybe they should just go to Foxwoods and you get some free drinks out of it.
It pretty much equates to that. I mean, you got to be on the inside. You got to get friends and family shares first. And then you sell them at the IPO. Why is a company selling their own shares then? That's why, to raise money. You know, obviously thought that the thing they were selling was worth more in the future. They wouldn't be doing that.
Yeah.
And then you wait for it to settle down. These things shoot up like a log coming out of the water, and then they sink back down a few feet, and then they level off at some price discovery over time when there's real trading value. And you only see like 6% or 8% of the company floated publicly. I mean, so what's the company really worth? I mean, these valuations are ridiculous. It's a great way to lose money for the common investor.
Okay, again, I'm going to suggest go to Foxwoods, go to Atlantic City, go to Las Vegas. You will have more fun. You will probably only spend the $500 that's in your pocket or your $100 or whatever your limit is, and you will get a free drink. It makes it worth it. Here's one more question from Tom. This is probably the opposite end of the spectrum, Jack. Tom says, should I just use an age-appropriate target date fund and forget about it? So that's like literally the opposite end of the investing spectrum.
Exactly. And, you know, if he's asking that question, the answer is probably yes. I think people who want to be more active investors or who want to hire Ray to help them, that's great. But this is sort of Ray in a box. It's not as good as the real Ray, but it's a heck of a lot better than buying Groupon or Pandora, and it's also better than just trying to wing it, you know. And if you buy in a target date fund, they'll charge you what, 1%, something like that.
Yeah, maybe a little more.
But you know, you will have an automatic mix of stocks and bonds, as we found out in 2008-2009. Sometimes the target date fund companies miss, and these funds that were supposed to be conservative lost big bucks, but they've bounced back. So again, I say it's not the best, but there are so many things that are worse than a target date fund. go for it.
And Ray, you feel like that, you know, if someone's got a couple, let's just like build this out. Like Tom's a young guy and he's got $2,500 in his 401k. Yep. Can he just put the target date fund in place and leave it alone? Because he's not going to do anything anyway.
Yeah. I like Jack's answer here.
Okay, good.
Now, I'm gonna approach it a little differently, but it's the same. I think it's the same place. And that is, why this product? This product was developed by financial industries, okay, for people, they say, look, there's people out there who want to set it and forget it, who don't want to pay attention, so we'll take that for them. We'll put them in, they pick the fund that's tied to their age, their retirement date. It'll be a suitable allocation of stocks, bonds, cash, and as that fund nears that target date, it'll rotate out of the stocks and go into more bonds and cash, get more conservative over time, which is what you should be doing on your own. If you like that concept and you like that product and it suits your needs, then go for it. It's fine. As Jack said, there's a lot of other things you could do that could be a lot worse and you could lose a lot more money.
Yep.
It's not a way to get rich quickly, but it's a way to preserve and build wealth slowly.
I'm kind of liking the get rich slowly thing myself.
You know, one other logic behind them, which I think is kind of interesting, companies like CBS or any others with a 401k were being asked for advice by people in the plans, and they couldn't really give that advice for all sorts of legal reasons. And the fund companies came up with this so that the default option could be a fund that actually made sort of sense instead of just putting people in the money market and nothing was happening.
And, and Ray, are we going to see exchange-traded funds pushed into the 401k environment? Is that going to start changing, or do you think that that's silly? You're like a 401k kind of expert.
Absolutely.
A business is involved in that.
The thing about a 401k plan, when you have a daily valuation, once a day valuation, you have to create a mutual fund type sleeve, a pool of liquidity, so you can allow people to get in and out. And what you do is you end up taking an exchange traded fund, an individual traded security that's priced in real time, and then you put it inside a fund, and then you only allow it to be priced
once a day,
and then you wrap fees around
it. Right, so what's the point?
And you make an expensive mutual fund out of a low-cost exchange-traded fund just to put it in a 401k.
Yeah.
Hello?
Can't we just put an index fund in there? Like,
so there are
really?
People out there that want to do it because the name ETF
is so
sounds
hot.
Sexy. It's hot. It's marketing appeal.
Yeah.
But it doesn't make, to me, as an industry, it makes a bit of sense to do it. Allow your people in a 401k plan to open up a self-directed brokerage account, and in the brokerage account, which is valued real-time throughout the day, they can just buy exchange-traded funds like
why
they can
stocks. Why are there not more
that's fund, a way to happen.
Why are there not more large plans that are just filled with index funds? I mean, that's very rare, even if perhaps in the CBS world. Like I'll give you an example. We look at the CBS 401k plan, where people who deal with money and investing all day long, and you open it up, and there's one index choice among six options. But you can load up on your CBS stock if you want it.
Well, large plans like those of Boeing, one of the largest defined contribution plans in the world.
Right.
Okay. Lockheed Martin, UPS, Sears, they all have index funds.
Right.
These mega large all have index funds because they're
bored.
Well, how
many people work at CBS?
A lot.
I don't know, like 40, 50,000 people must
be. CBS is no slouch. It's a big company, right? Most fiduciary boards of retirement plans, fiduciary committees, recognize the benefits of adding index funds for the obvious reasons that, look, it's a low-cost option that's going to give you at least relative market performance, and you can compare your active funds to that benchmark peer group in the plan and know if you got a good one or not.
Right,
right there. Participants can do it too.
Right.
You know, one reason, let's face it, is kickbacks. Because in some...
We like to call them 12B1 fees in our business.
Revenue sharing. You know, this is not a CBS issue. This is a small company issue where they go to the sponsor and they say, hey, we're going to set up this 401k plan for you. And by the way, you're going to get some of the fees, which is if you really lay it on the table, it's terrible. Yeah. But we know it happens.
Right.
Or it's a way to bring big 401k plan features to a small company 401k plan.
Yeah.
So they offer them with a lot of loaded funds and shares to be able to pay for the website and the statements and the phone service so that a 50-person plan can get the services that a big-person plan, but their fees are just ungodly.
Here's what I think. I think everyone should have TIAA
CREF
as like an option and let that be the benchmark. It's like such an easy, clean, cheap plan. What's the problem? What's the problem? Like, why do they have to just do educational organizations and universities and hospitals? Let us all use it.
You know,
I'm not chilling for them at all, but I'm just saying, like, it's such an easy plan to use.
It's a good benchmark.
Right?
You know, I was at the Morningstar Investment Conference in Chicago last week, and I was at a dinner, and I was standing in line waiting, getting some food, and I chatted with this guy who runs a small mutual fund company, and I'm not going to give any names.
Darn it.
So just out of interest, I looked it up when I got home. 2.79%. was the expense ratio.
Bless his heart if he can get
so
that.
So he's got to beat the market every year by 3%.
Yeah, he's got to start. He
to
starts
stay even.
January 2, minus 2.8% is where you start before the market opens. Let's get
crazy.
To another question. Here's this from Joy. I have an inheritance coming from my dad that will end up totaling around $40,000. I have about $3,000 of debt or less, could pay off with savings, but just making payments. I'm afraid the economy is going to tank again. What should I do with this money? I was thinking about something solid, like gold coins, perhaps. You know, by the way, nothing is considered solid if it is actually advertised in infomercials at 1 o'clock in the morning. That's the last thing. So solid gold coins versus investing in the market. Help! Joy wants to know, what should I be doing?
So Jack, that Snuggie I bought on the infomercial.
You know, I love
solid.
The Snuggie. I got the Snuggie as a gag gift. I had to say, it's quite excellent. You don't go too close to the fire with it.
Yeah,
it's a little bit flammable.
Okay. How did you find that out?
I got close to it. Honestly, I did. I went by the fire and I'm like, oh, this looks like it's about to burn, like momentarily. Okay, gold
or
coin.
Melt.
Okay, so let's just start. Yeah. Joy's got some debt. Can we just pay her debt off?
Yeah.
Number one.
Joy's got to do a little basic financial housekeeping, okay?
Okay.
Any debt, if you got surplus cash, you know, pay it off. Your cash is earning nothing. Your debt is going to cost you something.
Right.
So you save the spread. It's like reverse banking, okay, for yourself is what you're doing.
You're the banker.
Yeah.
You keep the VIG.
Absolutely. The second thing is look at things like an emergency fund, okay, so that Joy doesn't get caught with any financial surprises down the road. So you want to, you know, have 6 months living expenses or so in cash and then try to go earn some interest on that at like Everbank or Ally Bank or something like that.
Right.
You actually earn at least 1.25% or
right.
so.
2.5.
For the 5 year.
Yep. And you can take it out with small penalties.
That's
so
right.
Go
okay.
for it.
Okay. And then even better. And then you start looking at investing. But you know, you look at, are you going to buy anything? Like, are you looking at a down payment for a home in a couple of years or whatever?
Right.
So put those intermediate term needs out there.
That's right.
First.
That's great.
Before you look at
and Jack, no gold coins, right?
No gold coins. I mean, first of all, there's two issues here. One is, do you want to invest in gold? We could talk about that. But if you do want to invest in gold, do you really want to store these things? Do you want to have to go then cash them in?
My grandmother got out of Hungary with the gold in her pocket. All right, no, we're not going to tell you to buy gold coins, but it is true. She did get out of Hungary with gold in her pocket. But that said, I'm not a huge fan of, I love gold. I'm like a quasi almost, not a gold bug, but
ooh.
I love gold investing. I've owned it since, I mean, because you know, it was my first job on Wall Street, I was a gold trader. So I fell in love on the floor of the commodities exchange.
So I want a gold deal. What do I buy?
You know, I buy exchange traded funds. I mean, I used to buy
GLD?
Futures. GLDIAU is a cheaper version of it.
Mm-hmm.
You buy perhaps if you and remember, because you know, exchange traded funds, as Ray just said, it's traded like a stock. It costs you money every time you buy it. So you can buy a precious metals index. But the reality is, I love gold. I think I just looked at my portfolio an hour ago, and I think I have 2.5% in gold. Because I forced myself to sell it. So I've owned it from $300 up to $1,500. And so I keep, you know, sort of selling it out, make sure I have like between 2 and 3%.
So that would be 800 bucks over $40,000.
I mean, and
but,
that's what I'm
but
sort
you
of
know
saying.
What?
Like,
from
maybe $1,200.
From a financial perspective, that's not going to make or break this woman. But from a psychological perspective,
it might
be really good. If things do go to H-E double hockey sticks in a handbasket, is that
why
what
not?
My dad says?
Yeah.
You know, and then she feels like she's done something. She can ignore the 38 grand
right.
and just focus on that 1200 that becomes 13 when gold goes up.
Uh-huh.
So it's not a terrible plan.
All right. Now, here we go. We got one from, this is like, see, I love this because this is like a real financial question. It's not a market question. I am currently a PhD student in biomedical engineering at UCLA with tremendous debt, 100 grand in student loans, guys. This kills me. But biomedical engineering does sound cool.
And
I bet
PhD,
you can make money, right?
PhD is the MoneyWatch profile.
Right?
You know, that's who reads MoneyWatch.
Exactly. they probably shop at Whole Foods and Trader Joe's, too. I know we're going to psychographic, you know, analyze
you. Buy Green Mountain Coffee.
I know that investing is important. I've started as a freshman in college, and I have about $6,000 in stocks they've built up over the years. Two questions. Do you think that it is wise to take out subsidized student loans, about $5,000 from the government, and invest this money over the next year or two, the remainder of my time in graduate school? Two, I just moved my investments from low-risk stocks to something much more risky. What's low-risk stocks? What low-risk? All right, let's get back to that. Anyway, Robert went riskier. What do you think? Okay.
So you want to use the government loan business as a margin account, right? Buying stocks on margin, and that's his margin account.
Aha. interesting.
Right? Yeah, is that what he wants? Is that what he wants to do?
Yeah, I don't know. It's sad to me.
You can go to Interactive Brokers and get probably a lower interest rate, right?
I mean, but this is just...
One and a
quarter.
Can we
straighten this guy out right now? Come on, give me the straighten out.
Yeah, that's an arbitrage game you don't want to play at all. I like the idea of a college student starting to build up a little investment account, and if there's a way he can preserve that with a 20, 30, 40-year time horizon, fabulous. But do not play games thinking I'm going to spend this money or have to repay a loan with this money in 2 years
at
all.
Yeah, that's crazy. And and just generally speaking.
I knew a guy.
Yeah, oh boy, here we go. I knew a guy.
20 years ago, Jim Romer was his name. I wonder if he's, Jim, if you're still out there, check in sometime. He was a weather forecaster. He had a PhD or something like that in climatology or whatever, and crops and all that stuff. And he ended up writing weather reports. And he said, you know what? I could use these things to forecast the crop harvest for wheat and corn. And he started trading futures on that stuff. Made millions.
Really?
Millions for himself.
All right, but let's be honest. Robert's not doing that. Come on now.
You know, PhD, biomedical engineering. I mean, the point is invest in what you know.
Biotech stocks.
If he's investing, invest in what he knows.
Yeah.
Something he's really familiar with in his industry. And it's got to have good fundamentals to begin
with,
too.
But that said, I will tell you that my worst clients when I was in the business were those doctors who kept telling me that they knew these drugs and the pharmaceutical companies and this. And they were the worst because even if they got the pick right, they could not sell it ever. And they got psyched about the pipeline, which is, you know, kind of doesn't always happen the way they think it's going to happen. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know. I get a little bit... Get a little nervous about that.
For good reason.
Okay. So here we go. So that's a good one. I got one more here that I want to get to you guys. Hold on a second. Hold, please.
While you're looking, I'm going to say that the trade I really don't like is whatever your situation in life, taking this moment to go from low risk stocks, I assume he's talking blue chips, to high risk stocks, whatever they are. Yeah. I mean, as we talked about earlier, to me, and of course we don't advocate trading, but that's a really bad one.
Yeah.
I'd go the other way.
Here's one from Dan. I love these recent graduates. I've recently graduated college and got a job a few months ago. I have a general question. I turned 23 a few days ago, and I know how important it is to start early with investing. But I also know it's important to get my $19,000 in school loans paid off as quickly as possible. Should I start investing in mutual funds or get rid of these debts now? I'll also mention I'm taking advantage of the 6% Roth 401k match, while sometimes contributing more than 6% each check and getting 5% and a 5% match on it. What would you recommend that I do? So Dan, young graduate, 19 grand in student loan debt, contributing to his 401k,
getting
the match,
doing the Roth, doing all the right things.
So the extra money, pay down that debt, eh?
I would do a balanced approach here, okay? You do want to build up some liquidity on your balance sheet. In other words, cash, investments, and investment account that you can access for maybe a major purchase, like a down payment on a home. If you do an all-in strategy, just paying down the debt, it'll get you out of debt faster, which is great. It'll open up your cash flow sooner, which is great, okay? But it doesn't leave you options down the road. So you want to look at that, look at what the cost on that student loan debt is, look at consolidating the loans to get them down to lower cost, and do both. An aggressive strategy to pay off the loan, but build up some liquidity on your balance sheet.
And I love getting in the habit now at this age of putting money away. I think that's, I'm a behavioral guy today, but I think it's going to be, if he pays everything off and he's not in the habit of savings, who knows what he'll do with that extra cash flow.
Yeah, and so just, I want to just get one quick question here. This is my own question because, I had this radio show, Ray, and so I had a caller called in, the woman was like in total stress. She's like, oh my God, I've got to pay for my kids' college. I want to save for retirement. I want to do college. And generally speaking, I see these kids that come out of college with $19,000 debt. Not the worst thing in the world. That's not terrible. Right. But do you still believe that generally speaking, for the parents, take care of retirement, take care of your own retirement first and then do education funding after if you can afford it? Or that guy Kantrowitz sent me like a blistering hot email like, what are you talking about? Because I said, take care of yourself first. Like, your kid can go to public school, can go to the military like my friend Ray, can figure it out. And, there are loans and you'll get that. And so he's like, no way, that's just terrible. Like, parents shouldn't impoverish their children and da-da-da-da-da. What's your view on that?
Well, I still believe that you look at college when your kids are born and how you can afford to help contribute to that, whatever modest amount that is or major amount that is. But when it's come the day of college, you don't just raid your retirement accounts, and you don't put off your retirement savings to put your kid through college at all, any and all costs.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to end up being a burden yourself on the social systems and networks that we have, not being prepared for your own retirement, or, you know, God forbid, something happens to you health-wise, and that's sudden. There's just no loan or program to help you out there in any meaningful way. So there are lots of ways to finance college, work study,
right,
military,
right,
work while you're going through school,
yep,
and grad school, which
right,
I did, you know, a lot of people do. So, you know, there are a lot of ways to get through school, okay? And, you know, if you're trying to go to Harvard, but you have a Adirondack Community College budget,
right,
you know, you're going to have to look at that and figure out some practical ways to get through that without disrupting the financial situation of both people, the parent and the student.
And Jack, are you in it, or are you in it with me? Come on, get my back.
I'm with you. Oh, I'm totally. I wish I could say otherwise, but when you look at it on paper, you just can't. I mean, the key point is that there are many options for college, and there just aren't for retirement.
Right.
And people
right,
are living older and running out of money, and
Mark,
that's ugly.
That guy just banged me. I'm telling you. He was not happy with me. Well, you know what? It's like, I get...
Well, you tell him there's a reason why on an airplane they tell you when that airbag pops out.
That's it,
you put
man,
it on your face first,
choice,
and then you help the child
that's
next
right,
to you.
That's right. I've always used that analogy.
Because if you don't get that done, you're not going to be able to help them.
And I think that the other issue is that what he's really trying to say is that, look, you know, you don't want your kids saddled with all these loans because they're not going to be able to manage their own financial lives. But that's not... Right. It's not like one or the other. It's kind of like,
correct,
I sort of say, like, you know what, of course we want to make them responsible and we don't want to saddle them with loans, so then right size your kids' expectations, you know, kind of figure it out, dudes.
Or start at a low-cost school.
I love that.
Study like
go
hell
to,
and
go
get
to,
good grades and get up and upgrade.
I had a couple of, I loved that. I had one client whose kid went to CCRI, Community College of Rhode Island, went there mm-hmm, for a year, transferred to the University of Rhode Island, and by the senior year, guess what degree is on his wall? Brown University. It was just like, wow, that is a very good arbitrage. Like the cost
great,
of your college basically was, you know, all in about 50 grand for 4 years, and you ended up with a Brown University degree.
That's actually a great example of what the response should be to that guy. That the student learned more about getting value at low cost.
Yeah, that's
versus
right,
paying any cost
isn't
for the
that
same
amazing,
value. It's an amazing lesson.
It was a great
story. And
they'll
carry that the rest of their life.
Yeah, and the kid is a great kid and a total, and you know, you're absolutely right, because the one thing that is also interesting, and we talked about this with, what's that kid who was the Zach Bissonette? Remember
we did
that interview with him? And he writes extensively about like how college is basically a ripoff. But the cool thing is that when you have kids who are like that, they get very invested in their education and they're
right,
trying to extract as much as possible out of it.
Right.
And that's what I think is cool.
That's
I remember that's a professor really cool, in college joking that the kids were trying to get out of class or something, and he said, this is the most expensive thing that people don't want value for.
Yeah, right?
You know?
It's true. It's like, wow, I guess you like $50,000 for a great keg party. Fantastic.
Right.
Good luck with that.
But
yeah,
your guy who went through those three schools, he was not trying to get out of class, I suspect, by the time he was a
no,
senior at Brown.
No.
I suspect he was soaking it all up.
Yeah, and we were busy hanging out on the green, wondering when REM was coming to start playing. Okay, that's it for Ask the Experts.
Right.
To Ray's point, what a bunch of elite snobs we are.
Oh, stop.
We're going to close it out. Hey, thank you so much for watching Ask the
snob,
Experts.
You wear a Snuggie.
Yes, that's right. I've got a Snuggie. Flammable. Be careful. I'm Jill Schlesinger.
I'm Jack Otter.
I'm Ray Martin.
And tune in next week. We will be back with you. More of your questions. Don't forget, you can send us emails all week long. Ask the Experts at MoneyWatch.com, or you can go to the top right-hand corner, just click and we'll get that email. Shoot us your emails and let us know what topics you want us to cover. Thanks so much for watching. Ready, Roland? And we'll see you next week.
Find